Hello and welcome back to another video with It's Dr. Dan, and today we're going to be learning about solubility trends. Now, when it comes to a solubility trend, this is all about how you can label solutions based on how concentrated they are, meaning how much of a solute exists within the solution. So because of that, you can label them as saturated, unsaturated, or supersaturated solutions. And this is what I'd like to describe as the Goldilocks issue when it comes to solutions, meaning that it's very similar to that old nursery rhyme all about Goldilocks and the three bears, where she was trying all the different types of porridge that was too hot, too cold, and just right. Well, it's very similar to that here as well, where we have too concentrated, not concentrated enough, and just right is how we're going to be looking at concentrated solutions as well, and how that affects the chemistry behind them. So we're going to take a look at this and look at the different types. We're going to learn how to read the charts for how you can actually determine what type it is as well, and we'll go through many different examples and demonstrations to help show you what these all look like. All right. Let's go take a look, and thank you so much for stopping by, and let's go look at the next example. Solubility in the Goldilocks issue. So this is all about describing how solutions work. If you remember, a solution is composed of both a solute and the solvent. The solute was the minor part, which is dissolved by the solvent, which is the major component. Now, depending on how much solute you have, so in a way of like, how is it too sweet or is it too salty, right? When you're thinking of trying to dissolve these different things, will help you actually describe saturation. So the three types of saturation are all about how much of a solute there are. I like to think of it in terms of if you were to ever make, let's say, iced tea at home or maybe coffee, for example. And if you make iced tea and you are add sugar to it, well, you taste it and you might be like, oh, it's not quite sweet enough. That's an unsaturated solution, meaning that the solution is holding less than its maximum amount of solute, meaning you can add more. It's possible to add more. So now it's all about what is the limit that water can dissolve that solute. Because you can remember, water molecules are surrounding the ions here. So there's only so many water molecules available to surround all these molecules. So there's more to be dissolved is what unsaturated means. Saturated is when you reach the maximum threshold for the solute to be dissolved. So that's saturated. So that is like unsaturated is like not sweet enough. Saturated is just right. This is like, okay, the Goldilocks situation. This is right where you want it to be. You don't want to go any more, any less. It tastes perfect the way it is. Now, supersaturated is when it goes way beyond what it's able to handle. So that means that you are way above the maximum and it's still in solution somehow. This one has like the super strength that's available to them. We'll show you how that's exactly possible, right? How can you go above, right? Because usually when you're saturated, if you add more solid into it, it's just going to precipitate out. But there's a way to kind of trick the molecules into being super saturated. So this is all about not concentrating, being all the way up the top. So not concentrated enough, concentrated, and way too concentrated is the bottom. So let's look at this a little bit further and be dissolved. You can add more. So by adding solute, it will dissolve. So it means it's not that quite not sweet enough for you. You want to add a little bit more sugar to your tea. You can do that. Saturated means that no more can be dissolved, right? It's at its maximum. It's like, oh, this is just right. I don't want any more because any more would be like too gross. You'll have that, oh, it's too sweet. Meaning, and if you add more to it, then it'll start precipitating out. It will not dissolve. Supersaturated means that somehow you manipulated the science behind it and there's already too much dissolved. But how is that possible? Well, this is unstable. This is all about trying to manipulate the temperatures to make this possible. So we're going to talk about temperature trends and how that plays a role as well. But let's take a look at what supersaturated is all about, being that I have a demo for you to show this. So with the supersaturated solution, what this is all about is when you heat up a solution and you dissolve as much solid in it as possible, essentially what's going to happen is more can be absorbed. So if you cool the solution down, technically all of that that was dissolved can't fit in there, technically. So how can that actually exist? Well, right now it's in a state where it's in an equilibrium, but it's very fragile. It's very unstable. So all it takes is essentially one little crystal to be added to this solution. So what you see on the edge of the spatula here, or the scoopula, is one little tiny crystal. And we're going to add it here into the volumetric flask. And what you are going to see is it's going to precipitate. Notice how it looks like snow forming and ice is forming. All that precipitates out and it's expanding, expanding, expanding because there's too much inside solution. It's no longer stable. Therefore, it crystallizes completely and solidifies. It went from a liquid to a solid instantaneously because there was too much in the solution. So now it's a solid and fully precipitated. And that is supersaturation. That's when you have this special scenario just like this. All right, so how can you tell which version is it going to be? Well, the idea here is in order for us to tell, is it going to be saturated, unsaturated, or supersaturated, is you need to be able to read solubility tables. So what a solubility table is, it's all based on temperature. So they look a little bit like this, where we have all these different curves that are labeled for the different substances that we have available to us. Now, it's all about how water dissolves these salts into their electrolytes. So every single one of them is different. Like you can see, salt is relatively a straight line. You see sodium phosphate is going up. You see KNO3 is going straight up. Glucose is like here. And all of them have their own unique trend to them. Well, now when we're reading this, you can see the x-axis is temperature. The y-axis is solubility, meaning how many grams of your solute can dissolve for every 100 grams of solvent. So there's a limit that's available. So if we were to read this, we can label what a solution is. So let's say I wanted to do it for glucose. How could I label it? Well, let's take a look. So glucose is right here is the line for glucose. And what we are going to do is look at 40 degrees, and we see that it goes to right about here. So the way that we would trace that across is we see that at 40 degrees, we will have a solution that's right around 125, 130, so what does that tell you? That at 130 grams of glucose at 40 degrees, that's saturated. So let's kind of mark that spot for ourselves here. So here we'll do that in a different color. So this is where the saturation limit is for 40 degrees C. Okay, so let's kind of connect that. All right, so we'll write that as we have around 130 grams is saturation. Now, what would be considered unsaturated? So if we were to label that in blue, everything below here would be considered the unsaturated limit. So everything that's lower than 130 grams of solute. And now when would it be supersaturated? Well, that would be when you have anything above this purple point will be considered to be supersaturated. So we're going to label this part of it, and it's going to be anything greater than 130 grams of your glucose solute. Now, it's going to be a little bit easier than that typically when you're trying to read these and use them, but it's all about trying to pinpoint exactly where you're at on the graph. So let's take a look at some more examples and try to understand this a little bit more. Assume we have dissolved the following amounts of solute in 100 grams of water. Label them as unsaturated, saturated, or supersaturated. Okay, so the first one, 40 grams of sodium chloride at 100 degrees C. So what we're going to look at is we see here's 100 degrees C right at the corner of the screen. And we are going to take that all the way to NaCl, which is this yellow curve at the bottom. So where we're going to go is to 40 grams. And what you can see is those two points are meeting the yellow line that's here. So what that's going to tell you is that this is the saturation limit for NaCl. So NaCl is going to be saturated, being that it is matching that limit. Let's try the next one. It says 18 grams of sodium phosphate at 60 degrees C. So first we got to find sodium phosphate. That's the line that's right here in blue. So at 60 degrees, that will go right to about here on the curve. And what it says is 18 grams. So 18 grams is right down here, technically, on the y-axis. So it's well below where we're currently at. So what that means is that this is going to be unsaturated, that you can add more. In fact, you can go up to about 50 grams of sodium phosphate before it became saturated. The next one is sodium nitrate. So it says 100 grams of sodium nitrate at 10 degrees C. So here's sodium nitrate, is this blue curve here. So we are at 10 degrees C. So 10 degrees will trace up to our line. So right around here. And what we see is that, okay, at about roughly about 80 grams is how much can fit in solution at 10 degrees C. So what this would technically be is a super saturated solution because it is above where it needs to be. So you can kind of see like here's where 100 is and it's going like down to here where it would be the saturation limit. All right. So now another thing to kind of tell from these graphs as well is that solid solubility, notice how all of them are increasing as they go up in temperature. So as we go up, we're going kind of in this general direction here and we see it's increasing, right? And all of them are sloped upwards as a result. So most solids are generally more soluble the higher the temperature. One way to think of that too is if you have like iced coffee or hot coffee or hot tea and iced tea, is if you try to add sugar to any of the ice products, typically it doesn't dissolve very well. It takes a while for it to dissolve and it has to do with this. So usually they'll have like liquid sugar or liquid syrups and things like that to add because they're a little bit easier to dissolve. Now let's take a look at the next concept. So going back to that example I showed earlier about supersaturation, well, supersaturation is a result of temperature change, is what I mentioned. So let's say if we had sodium phosphate, for example, and I were to had that at 80 degrees C, so that's right around this point here. So if I were to cool that down, let's say I put the maximum allowed at 80 degrees, which would be roughly about maybe about 75 grams or so. So now if I cool that down to, let's say, 20 degrees down to here, well, technically the solubility limit's only 10. Well, what does that mean about all those grams that are already in solution if I put all of them in? Well, they're still going to be in solution until you add another crystal. So it's all about cooling it down. So typically, if you want to put more in solution, you have to cool it back down. So let's say if I put that 75 grams in the 80 degrees, this would be referred to as saturated. Now, if the 75 grams is still in there, this is now supersaturated because of the temperature, being that essentially the saturation limit around 20 degrees would be roughly around maybe 10 grams or so would be saturated. So it's all about labeling depending on where you add on the temperature scale. So let's take a look at our last example, all about saturation, how we label it based on temperature. The last part is all about gases. Well, we've been talking about solutions a lot and we have and have posted a ton of videos on gases lately. So, well, what about gases in water? Do they dissolve as well? Well, of course they do, right? So if you think of if you have a soda and has carbonation in it, or how do fish essentially live, right? They actually breathe oxygen too through oxygen that's dissolved in water. Well, gases do dissolve, but the thing about them is that their solubility is really quite different than solids. So on the left-hand side, I have the trends here for nitrogen oxide, oxygen, carbon monoxide, methane. And one thing you'll notice is that the slope is the opposite. They're actually all going downwards when temperature increases, meaning the hotter it gets, the more difficult it is for them to be able to dissolve. So now what exactly, why? What is that all about? Well, one thing about is being that that decreases as temperature increases, it's all about thinking of kinetic molecular theory. Gases behave like billiard balls. They bounce all over the place. And the more kinetic energy they have, the higher the temperature, the more they're going to actually bounce as a result. One way to think of it as an analogy is imagine giving like a five-year-old about 10 pounds of candy, right? They're going to be running around like crazy. Well, the higher the temperature goes, the more those gas molecules are going to move, and they're going to continue to kind of bounce around like a little ping pong ball, like going all over the place as a result. So the hotter it gets, the more of a problem that is. Now, in terms of a bigger effect, that could have a huge, even global effect as well. Global warming is one of the big issues that we're always bringing up in the scientific community. The hotter the Earth gets, the less oxygen that's actually going to be dissolved inside of water. So in terms of a marine wildlife that relies on oxygen to live, the hotter and hotter it gets, the less oxygen there is, meaning the less fish or even the smaller size that they will be when they grow. It can be a really big issue. So let's take a look at some other things as well when it comes to this too. The other part has to do with not only temperature of gases, but the pressure too. So gases, they're always under pressure all the time, just like students and ourselves. So the solubility of a Greek gas increases with pressure. I know this didn't quite fit anywhere else, but I wanted to make sure we talked about it. So I drew some cans of cola here to kind of try to emphasize exactly what this is all about. So let's say if you have a soda can or soda bottle, and if you're not opening it, one thing that's really inside of that inside of there is if you were to zoom in on the molecular level, you will see that there's going to be CO2 dissolved within the solution. And that's because there's so much CO2 in the space above it that's going to be pushing all the gases into solution. Now, when all of a sudden you open up the can and it goes psht when it opens, right? That standard sound that you've all heard before, all the CO2 is going to escape because it's going from an area of a really small volume to the open space, a big volume. Now, when that happens, well, all the gas molecules that are bouncing around, there's not going to be so many of them to try to keep CO2 in the liquid. Therefore, your soda is going to go flat over time. So one thing to kind of keep in mind is, well, how do you preserve soda for a really long time? Well, one is don't open it as many times if it's a 2-liter bottle. And if you're going to probably drink it, you know, try to probably drink as much of it in one sitting as possible. Because the more times you open it, the more the gas is going to have to fill up the entire space again to equilibrate once more. All right. That's all I have on solutions in terms of how to label them and how we're learning all about them. Until next time, thank you all so much for listening. And if this is your first time here, please hit that like and subscribe button. And please comment below if you have any questions. I would love to answer them. All right. I hope you all have a wonderful day, and I'll see you all later. Bye now.